That is called nonverbal communication. The best example of nonverbal communication is this. This is a legend who was set as an example and of nonverbal communication is Charlie Chaplin. And he has been successful only because he is good in his nonverbal communication. Now I have a question for you, all of you. You have 10 seconds. You will have to analyze this picture and you will have to tell me what you are analyzing in this. This picture is emitting some message, but we cannot identify what actually it is emitting. We can study it with our own mindset, what we think of saying it. So next, what content will be having for you? Firstly, introduction and importance will be given by Suchi. The ambiguity of nonverbal communication will be given by me. Types of nonverbal communication and role of nonverbal communication that also I have given. Global influence and functions of nonverbal communication will be explained to you by teachers. And again, I will explain you the category of nonverbal communication and smart ways to improve the nonverbal communication. So here are Esther part and Sujit.
Good morning to all of you. My name is Sujit Patel. I'm standing in front of you. I'm going to explain about nonverbal communication. But what is nonverbal communication? A communication where action speaks louder than word. Second, expression of emotions. Third, sign language and written words are not considered as nonverbal communication. Now I'm going to go towards definition. A symbol of symbolic behavior that includes all forms of communication except words. For example, body language. Second, nonverbal communication has been defined as communication without words. In nonverbal communication, it includes 7% of words, that is, you are seeing 33% of way of delivery and 60% of nonverbal communication. With the help of these, you can easily create your speech, delivery, things and all steps easily. Thank you.
Okay. So here comes the ambiguity of nonverbal communication. Now can anyone tell me what is the meaning of ambiguity or ambiguous? Anyone? Ambiguous means that the thing which is not clear in its meaning. The meaning of a thing which is not clear, specified, is called ambiguous. So how nonverbal communication is ambiguous? The first reason we have that it has multiple meanings. How we can say that it has multiple meanings? As you can see in this picture, there's a mother sitting with her two children. So this picture might emit a message that they might be sad or they might be terrorized. But it can be anything. It cannot specify the meaning of a picture. So that's why nonverbal communication has multiple meanings. Second is culturally bounded. How nonverbal communication is culturally bounded? It's culturally bounded because in different region, the different gestures mean different meanings. As you can see in the first picture, here's Winston Churchill. It's a picture of a time of World War II, and he's showing this gesture which here means is victory sign. And in the second picture, a girl is showing the same gesture, but here it means peace. This is a picture of a hippie movement in 1960s. So that's how we can say that nonverbal communication is culturally bound. The third one here is nonverbal learning disorders. What is nonverbal learning disorders? Many times you have observed that you are saying to your friends or someone else in your body language, you're doing some gestures, but they might not understand what you are doing. That's called nonverbal learning disorders. They might draw wrong meaning from them, or they might not understand what you are saying. That's called nonverbal learning disorder. So here, I have a game for all of you. I need 7 people from the crowd. Now, I'm going to do some gestures, and what command I will give you, you will have to copy that. And the person who do is wrong, will wrong, will be get disqualified.
Okay.
Stand that all persons are visible. This is small fish, this is large fish, this is short fish, and this is tall fish. Now I am commanding you now. Start fish, short fish, tall fish.
Latin America, while in others it is not offensive. cultures, it is considered as or interpreted as offense or violation of one's personal space. Eye contact is also the one of the forms of non-verbal communication, where differences are more striking. In America and Latin America, not in others' eye is a disrespect, or you might even look suspicious. While in Asian cultures, a long eye contact is especially an offense. Functions of non-verbal communication. We use non-verbal communication to duplicate verbal communication. We use non-verbal communication that is recognizable by most of the people of a particular group. Obvious examples include head nod or head shake to duplicate the verbal message of yes or no. For example, if a person asks you if you want to go to a movie, you might verbally answer yes with a head nod. This accomplishes the goal of duplicating the verbal message with non-verbal message. We use non-verbal communication to replace verbal communication. If someone asks you a question, instead of a verbal reply, you might choose to simply nod your head. We replace verbal communication with non-verbal communication. We use that is easily recognizable by people, like a wave, head nod, or head shake. This is used by human babies to view school. We use non-verbal communication to complement verbal communication. If a friend tells you that she got promotion and a pay raise, there are a number of ways to show your enthusiasm verbally and non-verbally. First, if you explain, "Oh, that's wonderful, I'm so happy for you," at the same time smiling and hugging your friend, you're using non-verbal communication to complement your verbal communication. Unlike duplicating or replacing, communication that complements cannot be used alone without a verbal message. If you simply smile and hug your friend, the interpretation of that message can be more ambiguous than using it to complement your verbal message. We use non-verbal communication to accent verbal communication. When non-verbal communication complements verbal communication, we also use it to accent verbal communication. For example, "I'm very angry with you." To accent this statement, we can say, "I'm very angry with you," putting your emphasis on "very" to demonstrate your anger. In this example, we use our tone of voice, which serves as non-verbal communication that accents the message. We use non-verbal communication to contradict verbal communication. Imagine that you visit your boss and she asks how you are enjoying your new work assignment. You might feel obligated to answer positively because it's your boss asking. However, your non-verbal communication contradicts your verbal message, and your boss may consider that you're not really enjoying your new assignment. In this example, your non-verbal communication contradicts verbal message to your boss that you don't really enjoy.
So here we come to the category of non-verbal communication. So the first category we have is kinesis, that is body movements. In the body movements, your gestures, your posture, your eye contact, your facial expressions all comes in. You can easily identify a person with its gestures, its body language and its expression, that the person is confident or involved. The second is proxemics. This theory tells you the distance you exchange with a person, your relation with that person. The first is intimate. In this section, your bestest friends and family comes in. So you share 1 to 1.5 feet distance. And if you want to say something to someone, I mean, whispering in their ear, you also do that. Second is person, 1.5 feet to 4 feet, and in this your good friends and family members comes in. The second is social, that is 4 feet to 9 feet. In this, the persons you might know, but you might not know very deeply about them. They are quite like a little bit strangers. And the last one is public, beyond 9 feet. That is, a speaker shares with its audience and they have a large crowd. The third one is tactical communication. This communication means the communication which we do by our touch, when you touch someone's body. If I'm making a handshake very tightly with a person, very strongly, it depicts that I'm trying to dominate that person. And if I do it very lightly, it shows that I'm in confidence. If I do it the right way, is to maintain a slight pressure and shake it twice. Don't do it very strongly, it emits a very wrong message. By hug and aggression, the hug represents that we don't hug every person we meet. Which whom we share a personal relation. So what can you tell from a person when if you are on call with him? You can easily analyze his voice. The person is aware, the environment, the background, you can easily analyze that the person is at home or at road. You can easily hear the voice of traffic coming. So that's how normally you draw some message. The appearance. In appearance, your clothing, your jewelry, your perfume and UTX comes in. Now clothing, what is the perfect clothes for a formal meeting? You will have to wear a good pair of formal trousers or jeans and a light color shirt with a blazer and a tie or bow. Shoes that might be black or brown, and the color of your shoes must match the color of your bed. Paralanguage. Your pitch, your volume, how you say the words, your diction, your voice quality says a lot about you. That you might be a confident person or an underconfident person. To maintain a good pitch is very important when you are talking to a person. Don't speak too loud or don't speak too slow. And the rate which you speak, don't run too fast, don't speak too fast or don't speak too slow. Maintain a good tempo. Now, these are the things what your body language says about you, or you might can analyze a person through his or her body language. First is eyes. Eyes says a lot about a person. If a person is trying to lie to you, he might see in his upright corner like this and try to imagine or make a lie. That's how you can understand the person is lying to you. And if the person is seen in the up left corner like this, then that person might try to recover something from his memory. The second one is lips. Your lips also says a lot about you. If a person is locking his lips inside his mouth like this, then the person might disagree from what you are saying. If a person is constantly biting his lower lip like this, then this shows that the person is in stress or in some tension. And when a person speaks loud, the another signal is that your lips get dry and they try to wet it up through their tongue. So that's how you can also analyze the person is lying to you or not. Your hands. How your hands says about you. Now let's suppose if I am talking to you and you are hiding your lips like this. This shows that you are trying to make yourself inside you are trying to hide something from you. If I am locking my hands like this, this is called a defensive position, in which a person is not ready to open with the second person. The fourth one is legs. Now, how can you analyze a person with his legs? If in a social gathering, if a person is forming a V like this from his legs, that is a signal that the person is ready to interact with the whole people which are present there. And if his legs are straight like this, then this shows that he is also ready to interact. But if no one interacts, it doesn't make any difference to him. If its legs are forming a A like this, this means the person is underconfident and don't try or don't eager to mingle with all other members. The fifth one is smile. Now, the duration of smile also indicates that the person is interested in a talk or a not. If a smile is last for 7 to 6 seconds, that shows that it is a real smile and the person is originally interested in it. If the smile is of 3 to 4 seconds, then this shows that the person is faking the smile and not that much interested to you. If the smile is of 0 to 1 second, then this shows that person is not at all interested in you. And you should stop your talk. Your posture. Now, maintaining a good posture is very important. What's a good posture? Your shoulders should be straight and the distance of your legs and the shoulder should be equal. Your head should be straight and you have to make an eye contact to the person to whom you are speaking to. Use your gestures and body language to emit your emotions better. Now, here are some smart ways that you can improve your posture. The first one is facial expressions. Use your facial expressions as much as you can because that helps you to convey your emotions better. Second is relax and be natural. Don't try to fake because other persons might understand that you are faking and they are very easily they can analyze. So relax and be natural. The third one is use hand gestures. Because hand gestures make the audience to connect with you and conveys your message better. Acknowledge. Acknowledge people to whom you are talking to. The fifth one is posture. So as I told you, what is a good posture? You have to maintain a good posture. And the fourth one is voice. As a pitch, voice quality, volume and rate of your voice, you have to maintain it as we have heard in the paralanguage. So here, we rest our presentation and thank you for listening.